how do we actually even start studying this area, right? Well, you need to look at the fundamentals, right? So this is where we look at the physics of a crash. Okay, so for example, here you see that you have a car that's actually approaching a wall at a particular velocity, okay? And then you can see that there is actually a force F that gets applied on the car when it crashes. So first question, what is the source for this force? Can anyone tell me? Newton's third law, that's correct. When that force is going to get applied, what's going to happen is, initially the front part of your car, okay, which is typically called as a crumble zone, is going to crush, right? The front part of the car is going to get crushed a little bit. And then after that, what's going to happen? After that, your car is, the solid components or the rigid components of your car is going to impact the wall. And that's going to result in a rebound of the vehicle, meaning the car is going to hit the wall and it's going to come back. And it's going to come back by certain amount of distance, correct? You take that distance, and then you also take the depth of the crumble zone, like how much, you know, the crumble zone got deformed. You take those two distances, and that distance you are going to call it as D, capital D. So that's how much the car gets pushed back at the end of the day. Now you take this reaction force, and if you multiply this by D, that is going to be the work done, which is associated towards this crash. That is the amount of energy that is available when crash takes place. That's it. Now, here's the thing. If you take this entire energy and if you basically impart it on the person who is driving the car, for sure they're going to die. So the whole idea behind crashworthiness engineering is to take this energy and dissipate it in a way that it actually goes around the passenger. So you cannot design a system where 0% of the energy is imparted to the passenger. The passenger is going to get some amount of energy, okay? But the idea is to take that energy and design the structures in your car so that the energy is dissipated away from the driver or the passengers. Okay, these are called as energy pathways. It's an important term that people use in occupant safety generally. This is the fundamental physics, okay? How can we take the value of rebound plus crash? That's a great question. What do you think? The answer should be fairly simple for that. How will you calculate the value for rebound and crash? Well, equations of motion can be used to predict it using simulations. That's correct. But from an experimental point of view, that's why when crash testing takes place, there's a lot of slow motion cameras which measure multiple views. There's a top view and a side view, and the cars are also marked clearly so that you can easily measure all these quantities. You can measure the deformation in three-dimensional space with very good temporal resolution as well. But in today's presentation, like I said, we are primarily focusing on how you can actually calculate these things through a computer simulation, all right? And the answer to that question is this equation right here. So can anyone tell me a little bit about the mathematical characteristic of this equation? What is it that we are looking at here? This is actually called as the equation of motion or a governing equation. So this is an equation of motion to be very specific, because in this particular equation, you take into account the forces that's acting, and your end result is to compute the displacement. That's it. Let's ask a couple of questions here. So on the right hand side, we have F_ext. What do you think that is? It's the external force, and this external force is actually a function of time. And what you're looking at here is actually a second order differential equation. Now, in terms of ordinary differential equations, the right-hand side term is called as, what is the right-hand side term called as with respect to ordinary differential equations? The right-hand side term is called as the source term. Now, the source term is what is, so in other words, you can think of it like this. So U here is going to be your displacement, okay? Now, in order to get displacement, okay, in order to get displacement, the external forces should be present. In other words, the external forces is called as the source term. Because if the external forces are not present, you will not get any displacement. In other words, your car is just going to be completely intact, which means it has no obstacles. The car can still be traveling, but it has not been subjected to any external force. So just looking at this particular equation, you can actually learn a lot. And the whole idea behind crashworthiness. And interestingly, this is the similar type of equation that's solved for multibody dynamics itself. And that is why I always insist that, you know, learning these equations is very important, because if you learn these equations, you know, it doesn't matter which field you're interested in, multibody dynamics, crashworthiness, robotics, you can actually, if you understand the math behind them, you can actually get into these areas quite easily, because all of them are ultimately solving an equation of motion. There are some additional terms, and if you understand those additional terms, that's it. Okay, so here, the first term basically takes into, this is basically F equal to ma, guys. Okay, if you take F equal to ma, Newton's second law, that's what you're looking at here. And the force is written as mass times acceleration. And what is acceleration? Acceleration is nothing but the second order derivative of displacement. So that's why you have d square u by dt square. And then you have c times du by dt. So what is du by dt? That's the velocity. What is c? C is a damping matrix. And k is, at the end of the day, the stiffness matrix. So when you're setting up a crashworthiness, what you are interested in is solving this entire equation for the entire car. Now, why is that difficult? Well, if you take damping coefficient or if you take stiffness, different locations in your car have as different stiffness values. Okay, and similarly, if you take mass, right? If you take mass, the mass in a car is not evenly distributed. Typically, the center of gravity, it's towards the bottom of the car. Generally, that's done for better driving performance. So your mass matrix basically computes how the mass is distributed throughout your car. And similarly is the damping coefficient. Now, damping coefficient depends on the material that you're using. And similarly, your stiffness. Stiffness, again, depends upon the material that you're using and how materials are distributed. So you take this simple equation or simple looking equation and you solve it for your entire computational space, which in this case is your entire car plus the wall on which the car is going to impact. And then when you solve this equation, you can actually get the displacement at each and every point on the car as a function of time. Okay, I'll repeat the statement again. You're getting the displacement on each and every point on the car as a function of time. This is called as a transient simulation. Why is this called a transient simulation? Because you're getting quantities as a function of time.